Minnesota Landscapes, full program.
This program was made possible in part by grants from the Minnesota State Arts Board, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Jerome Foundation.
What happens on the farm affects everyone in the nation. Everyone is involved in agriculture in one way or another, whether it be in the production or the consumption portion of it. But agriculture is extremely important.
To be a farmer, it isn't just a profession. I think to be a farmer and to be a family on the farm is, it's almost an emotion. Because, you know, this black field or this land that we're on is a part of Canton history. Great-grandfather Canton came to this part of Minnesota in the 1860s, and he came in one of those covered wagons. And he lived in a cave in a sod hut over here on the Chippewa Riverbank. And so when we talk about this place, and Chuck talks about a challenge, it also means that this is history that we're making. It's land is a piece that ties generations together. Land has been the center of struggle from the very beginning, and that we as farmers here in Minnesota and in the United States need to also have a sense of justice toward the land and toward the people who live on the land.
Well, I guess that's the foundation of the whole thing, as far as I'm concerned, is the land. This is our livelihood. If we don't take care of that and make that produce, why, we've all got a serious problem.
I don't know if we have a right to say we own this land. We've given a lot to it. We've worked hard at it. And I don't know if our grandfathers had farmed it, if we'd feel any different. I mean, it's just a thing that belongs to everybody. But we are, right now, the tenants, and it isn't... there's nothing permanent about that.
to be involved with land is a total kind of lifestyle. It's just there. It's a part of your gut, and it's a part of your blood, and it's a part of your thinking. It's with you all the time, and the whole thing comes out of a sense of struggle, a sense of survival. It makes the difference to us whether the sun shines today or whether it rains today. It's just such a total part of everything that you are and everything that you think and everything that you believe as a person.
Thank you. not supposed to do anything. It's supposed to be something.
I mean, after it's
what?
After it's fruit.
Well,
while it's on display, I see after that.
Well, you see, they're recording our comments. So they're going to listen to what people have to say.
Well, they're recording your voice.
And yours, too. You probably picked it up real quick.
Excuse me. I don't know if you want to. Oh, shoot. Oh, impossible. Do you guys have Canon mail?
Two
Canon to Canon mails?
Canon mail to Canon mail?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hurry up.
I need a mail cannon to mail cannon, because...
For that?
Yeah, to get from here into my box, or else
okay,
I need cannon
where
to phone.
Where did they come
Do you guys
from?
Have a mail cannon to a phone plug?
Phone plug?
It's a very carefully scored piece. It is repeatable every time. I guess in a sense, because I teach at an art school, I've kind of gotten into drawing in a funny way. And this, in a sense, was a kind of a drawing in that this image of the bicycle, it said music to me in the sense of being two notes, but it also said, you know, bicycle, and that's part of the of this piece also. I've given the players these kind of graphic things which, for me, were a visual pun between music notation and bicycle ease, if you will. I just like exploring sounds, because it almost feels like this is the only thing I could possibly be doing. It's some kind of, I guess, internal drive that just pushes me towards doing this kind of music. This is a self-made pickup device, which I have to attach to the frame, which will pick up the vibration of the spokes from, you know, the metal of the frame. And then from here, the sound travels up the wire to the amplifier, which is over here. And once we get some batteries on here, then once the spokes are flicked with a plastic thing here, the sound of the spokes comes out. The thing is, once the parade is in process, you'll be able to hear brake sounds amplified, and the bearings and everything else will get to be amplified too. It all, you know, it'll all be coming out through the speakers. The idea is to bring music into the streets, literally, actually.
So it's okay?
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay, great.
There you go. Now, the thing is that each bicycle sounds differently, and some are louder than others, and but, you know, it's, again, the fact that there's, in fact, 30 of us, which will make the piece work, so don't turn the gain up too loudly.
Okay.
I This was a wonderful run. This was about the best run that I've ever had on this piece.
It's not art unless it's documented, huh?
That's for sure. And that's my last shot.
And I think this is our last shot.
How about that?
How did you get involved in all this?
I think probably the way most people did. We bought a puppy one time, you know, nice little husky puppy. And then we got another one because that was so nice, a female.
Added to it about a year later with a second dog as a companion dog. And then we had a third one, we had a litter, and now we're up to 33.
Started out with a Siberian Husky puppy, and just kind of got the urge to have a small team and putts with, and then the urge just kept getting to have a bigger team and a faster team, and started racing then.
The A-class teams, they are the unlimited size teams, 9 dogs or more. They're running a total of 13 miles as they did yesterday.
Good, well-trained and a working dog team is worth a lot of money. I mean, it's because the man has spent time individually on the dogs and then spending the time of training the lead dog.
It's not like a machine. You can't turn a key on. You have to learn to let your dogs tell you what to do, let your dogs know how you should feel. If you're nervous, your dogs sense it. You can't let any of those emotions get in your way.
But that's what you're striving for, just to get them to do all work for you as a team. When I first got into it, I thought it was such a solitude out there, because all you see is just the nature, the snow. It's cool and refreshing. The dogs aren't making any noise. You hear the feet pounding on the snow and the runners kind of hissing along. And it's just, I don't know, just kind of a nice thing just to go out and get away from everything.
You feel good, you feel big, you feel like you've really accomplished something.
You see deer out there and squirrels.
You're mellow, you're high. It's a fantastic feeling.
You get those dogs all working together, and you get them out there on that lake, and they're just working like a machine, steady. Everybody's doing his job, and they'll just go and go and go doing it. That makes it all worth it.
I teach my dogs to go home. When they're coming down the last part of the trail, I start yelling home to them, and they associate home with getting home and stopping and resting and getting a treat. And usually throw them a piece of beaver, and it kind of psychologically prepares them for when they're tired, they'll run for that treat.
Oh, that was a long, rough trail today.
Yeah?
Yeah. Just couldn't get them to turn on, couldn't get them to open up until the halfway point. And then coming home, they opened up and turned on pretty good.
I like it when they do good, you know, when they'll go out there and give me everything they've got. I don't care where I place.
I had a buddy that was in the paratroopers, and he said the next best thing to jumping out of an airplane was a dog team. So that's just about what it's like. It's a good, smooth feeling when they're running good.
It's just unique. You can't compare it with anything.
Thank you.
goes, don't jiggle. No moving now.
Minnesota Landscapes was made possible in part by grants from the Minnesota State Arts Board, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Jerome Foundation. Thank you.